on today's Primetime Local News. Remote starters for your vehicle, what you need to know in this freezing weather.
Remote start it so that way it warms up the engine, gets the oil loosened up since it'll be rock hard at this temperature.
And the weather has finally reached minus 50 with the wind chill. What a meteorologist is telling us about this deep freeze.
We have not seen temperatures in Lloydminster reach down to the minus 37, minus 38 degree range that we saw earlier today in the last 10 years.
And among the many issues discussed, job creation was a top discussion of the Fair Deal panel in the border city.
I think that's really important for people to understand that there isn't a one size, one solution fits all.
Prime Time Local News, serving the Lakeland and Midwest regions.
With the average today sitting in the minus 30s, a lot of people are counting down the days until this cold snap comes to an end. Our Jasmine King has more on where this cold is coming from and when it will come to an end.
Over the past few days, with the wind chill, we've been closer to minus 50 degrees, and it seems like this cold snap has appeared out of nowhere, when in reality, this deep freeze has been making its way down from the Arctic.
We have this Arctic ridge of high pressure in place over the area, and that's what's been driving in the frigid air. It's coming in straight basically from the North Pole. It's part of an upper level complex known as the polar vortex, so the coldest pool of air that normally sits over the North Pole. An extension of that has been sliding south over the Lloydminster area.
Not only are we experiencing some of the coldest temperatures across the country, but Western Canada has some of the coldest temperatures in the world.
We are looking at some of the coldest temperatures across the entire Earth, actually. In the Southern Hemisphere, it's summer right now, but in the Northern Hemisphere, we are seeing some of the coldest air. Not always the coldest. Sometimes that air does retreat over Siberia, parts of Russia, but we are definitely in one of the coldest pockets on Earth right now.
The current temperatures are ones the border city hasn't experienced in a few years.
We have not seen temperatures in Lloydminster reach down to the minus 37, minus 38 degree range that we saw earlier today in the last 10 years. So that just gives you an idea of how unprecedented this cold snap is. That being said, we have seen minus 50 wind chills in the Lloydminster area over the past few years, but temperatures were slightly warmer. The wind was just a bit stronger.
Quinlan says the start of next week is when we will be seeing temperatures rising back up to normal winter temperatures. Jasmine King, Primetime Local News.
When the temperatures start to drop, a lot of people turn to remote car starters to start their vehicles. Remote starters give drivers the ability to start and warm up their car from indoors without a key. Comfort and convenience are the biggest selling features of the devices, but they can also help prevent vehicle thefts.
All the factory theft protection is still in place. So as soon as you open the door, it'll either shut off for some of the push to starts, or most regular vehicles, even if you break in, get in, as soon as you touch the brake, it'll shut off, as well as the steering wheel column is still locked.
Many newer cars now come with pre-installed car starters, but they often lack some of the features of the third-party starters, such as a longer runtime and the ability to start your car with a smartphone.
The manufacturers install excellent remote starts. The only issues they mainly have is runtime. Most of them will run for between 8 and 12 minutes. And then you can only start them twice, which is okay when it's minus 10, but when it's minus 40, not so great.
And most remote starters range in price from $300 to $500. The Fair Deal panel is asking Albertans for their opinions on different topics affecting the province. And last night was Lloydminster's turn to have their voices heard. Eric Bay has more on that story.
The Fair Deal panel has been tasked with listening to Albertans on subjects like creating an Alberta pension plan or having a provincial constitution. And the panel has seen a wide range of ideas brought forward.
There are like 60 ideas that have come forward, not just the 9 that are in the mandate letter. So how do we sort through those? How do we figure out what works together? That's a really important discussion. It's a good strategy to figure out. And you can do that in government, but I think this government's been wise to say, let's hear what the people have to say.
Lloydminster marks the 7th stop for the Fair Deal panel, and from Calgary to Fort McMurray, many of the same issues have been brought up. However, from community to community, those experiences have been different.
it's got a local flavor. I think that's really important for people to understand that there isn't a one size, one solution fits all. There is a deeper understanding of certain issues in certain communities because their experiences have been different. And I think that's really important for us to understand and hear those stories. What does fairness and unfairness look like and feel like in Lloydminster as compared to Grand Prairie, as compared to Edmonton?
There was some concern about the panel's discussion topics from people in attendance, specifically how these topics will help with issues such as job creation.
Of all the things that have been discussed, and listening to the concerns that we hear from people in our community, will any of these issues actually make a difference for us here in Lloydminster relative to more jobs, a better economy? And I haven't heard anything. All I've heard is a level of frustration because none of this has in fact happened, and I think that's still an ongoing challenge.
The panel will finish its tour with town halls in Airdrie and Medicine Hat before submitting their final report on March 31st. Eric Bay, Primetime Local News.
City Council granted first reading of a proposed land use bylaw amendment as part of the land exchange agreement between the City of Lloydminster and Husky. In order for the agreement to go forward, a subdivision must occur and fit in the parameters of the bylaw. The move benefits both parties in allowing them potential land use in the future.
Well, certainly they're one of our biggest employers, and they contribute a lot to the city, and we're certainly glad to have them.
And making sure no steps in the process were skipped was also important.
Administration demonstrated that they did the due diligence, and they're aware of it, they're on top of it. So, making sure that you have the time to do it in a way that you're going to protect the city and the city's interest is really that's what's most important.
I'm fine with this one coming back to us and having some public comments in terms of whether there's any concerns around the potential uses of the land, and we'll see where it lands.
Public hearings for the two bylaws will take place February 10th at 2 p.m. Well, it feels like the deep freeze isn't letting up anytime soon. Here's our Abby St. John with this frosty weather update.
Thanks, Judy. And you're right, we are still under that extreme cold warning. The entire province of Alberta and the majority of Saskatchewan under that extreme cold warning. So definitely be cautious about going outside if it's for a prolonged bit of time. Minus 34 here in Lloydminster, but it'll feel closer to minus 47 with that wind chill. Earlier today, we were in the minus 50s with that wind chill. So things have stayed relatively cold for the majority of today. Winds coming out from the west-southwest at 16 kilometers per hour. Across Alberta, minus 33 out in Cold Lake and Athabasca, minus 30 in Edmonton and Edson, and in Whitecourt, minus 31 in Jasper, minus 34 in Red Deer, minus 28 in Rocky Mountain House, and on the Saskatchewan side, minus 29 in Prince Albert, minus 34 in Melfort, minus 33 in Saskatoon, and minus 32 in Meadow Lake and in North Battleford. Overnight in North Battleford, the temperature will drop to minus 39, and the wind will be coming in from the west northwest at 9 kilometers per hour, and then pick up to 11 kilometers per hour tomorrow coming in from the west. And there'll be a daytime high of minus 31. In Cold Lake, overnight, it'll drop to minus 37, and that wind will be at 9 kilometers per hour coming in from the west northwest, and pick up to 11 kilometers per hour coming in from the west tomorrow with a daytime high of minus 31. Here in Lloydminster, overnight, the temperature will drop to minus 38, and that wind will be coming in from the west at 11 kilometers per hour, which will remain that way tomorrow with a daytime high of minus 33, which will feel closer to minus 44 with that wind chill and a low of minus 38. On Thursday, there will also be a low of minus 38 and a high of minus 27, which will feel closer to minus 32 with that wind chill. On Friday, there's a 60% chance that we could see some snowfall with a daytime high of minus 24, which will feel closer to minus 37 with that wind chill and a low of minus 27. That is a look at your three-day forecast. We'll have more news coming up after the break.
Well, hockey fights are known for getting the crowd pumped up, giving the teams momentum and bringing a certain electricity to the rink. However, sometimes they can result in injury or suspensions. The Lloydminster Bobcats give us their insight on Cassian Kachuk tussle. Our Montana Getty has more on this week's Beyond the Boards.
So he was coming down pretty fast, but he turned before the hit. And right on cue, as we talked about the battle in Alberta, and here these two go out of hard, and Cassian's throwing all of them.
It's always interesting because I think now you're going to see, the seats are going to be full at the next game. So from a business standpoint, it was probably a great thing for sports and a great thing for the Battle of Alberta. So, the part of it is Cassian's got to sit for two now.
The amount of fights seen in hockey games are going down more and more over the last couple of years, but there are still some good reasons to throw hands.
Well, if there's a momentum shift, if we're going into the third losing, you got to get some energy in the building. Or if somebody lays a dirty hit and takes advantage of one of your players, you got to take exception to that and fight them. So,
Coach Dubé says although he sees the fight from Cassian and Kachuk's point of view, it's always great to see opinions on Twitter. Montana Getty, Primetime Local Sports.
Beyond the Boards is brought to you by City Center Auto Body. For over 35 years, City Center Auto Body has been your go-to auto body shop.
And now to a chilly weather forecast with our Abby St. John.
Thanks, Judy. Taking a look at our satellite radar, we are still in that extreme cold warning. Some snowfall in the Edmonton, just outside of the Edmonton area, and in the Vegreville area as well, up in Cold Lake a little bit here and there from last night, and then down in the North Battleford area, just a tiny bit, but nothing too severe as of yet. Here in Lloydminster, we don't really have any signs of snowfall until around Friday, about a 60% chance of snow then. Minus 34 currently here in Lloydminster, as well as in Maidstone and in St. Walburg. Minus 32 in Macklin and North Battleford. Minus 33 in Meadow Lake. Minus 31 in Pearson and Green Lake. Minus 28 up in Isle of Cross. And on the Alberta side, minus 35 in Marwain. Minus 33 in Provost and Vermilion, Cold Lake and Lac La Biche. Minus 34 in Bonnyville and Vegreville. Minus 31 out in Edmonton. And minus 37 in St. Paul. For your tomorrow's forecast, minus 33 here in Lloydminster, as well as in Wainwright, Vegreville, Vermilion, and Marwain. Minus 34 in St. Paul, minus 31 in Provost, Bonnyville, and Cold Lake, minus 30 in Lac La Biche, and minus 32 out in Edmonton. On the Saskatchewan side, minus 26 up in Isle of Cross, minus 29 in Green Lake, minus 30 in Pearson, Meadow Lake, and Macklin, minus 32 in Maidstone, minus 33 in St. Walburg, and minus 31 out in North Battleford. Overnight across the regions, temperatures are quite cold for overnight as we're in that under that extreme cold warning. Minus 36 in Meadow Lake, minus 31 in Isle of Cross, minus 37 in Pearson, Bonnyville, and Provost, minus 38 in Paradise Hill, and minus 39 in Unity, Murnham, and Wainwright for your overnight temperatures. Your school day forecast for tomorrow here in Lloydminster at 8 a.m. it'll be minus 38. And then by the time recess rolls around, the sun should be nice and shining bright. However, the temperature will not reflect that as it will be minus 36. Then minus 34 around lunchtime. And then by the time school is out, the sun will still be out, but it'll be minus 33 and a low of minus 38. On Thursday, it'll be a high of minus 27 and a low of minus 38 as well. On Friday, a 60% chance of snow, like I said, with a high of minus 24 and a low of minus 27. So your weekend off on Saturday will be a high of minus 26 and a low of minus 31. On Sunday, a high of minus 22 and a low of minus 29. Then you start your week off again on Monday. It'll be a high of minus 18 and a low of minus 28. And then we get a bit of warmer weather than we've seen, with a high of minus 7 and a low of minus 21 on Tuesday with a nice sunny day. That is a look at your 7-day forecast. We'll have more news and the question of the day coming up after the break.
We all know it's freezing out there, and this week has been the coldest week this season, with a minus 50 with the wind chill. And the question was, how cold is it for you? How cold is too cold for you? That's the question. I say it's freezing and I don't like it at all. I've never had this kind of weather in my entire life. Minus 50 with a wind chill? That is craziness to me.
Yes, we've had that before, so it's not new, but it's definitely horrible to go through every single time.
Yeah.
The comments that we did get, they're in agreements that it's too cold. And one comment, if it's too cold for penguins, it's certainly too cold for us, which is coming from the Calgary Zoo had to put their penguins back inside because it was too cold, because they have a walk with penguins at the Calgary Zoo, but they had to cancel it because it was too cold for the penguins.
That's crazy. Even for the polar bears, I'm pretty sure this is cold. But this is way more than I can handle, I think. I think minus 20, okay, you know, well, I kind of get used to that. But minus 50, I think that that's like, I want to go to a different country, but I got to get used to it, right?
Yeah,
that's
definitely how it works, the wind that hurts. Makes it the worst part, because it's so cold when it hits you. When the wind isn't blowing, when it's kind of steady, it's fine.
It's bearable.
You can stand outside for a bit, but once that wind starts gusting, it's bad.
It is bad. Well, something nice to look at are these pets. Thanks for sending your pets for us for a chance to win a gift card from the Pet Pad.
We want to see your pets. Send photos of your pet and their name to our Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram to have them featured on Pet of the Day. Your name will be entered into a weekly draw for a gift certificate from the Pet Pad.
Tracy Rogers from Synergy is joining us today on Primetime Local News. Tracy, thank you for coming out in the cold weather, first of all.
It is very cold. Thank you for having me, Stacey.
Well, you're welcome. And we're going to be talking about post-Christmas debt. And now, unfortunately, not only is the weather cold and depressing, now is the time when a lot of credit card bills start coming in from Christmas. A lot of the hangover, for lack of a better term, I guess, from everything that was spent. So we want to talk about ways to kind of get out of that, you know, fix what you've done, I guess, over Christmas. Mm-hmm. So what's the best place to start?
Well, for some people, holiday spending can get out of control very quickly and before they even know it. And when those bills start coming in, like you said, they realize that they're way too far into debt that they won't be able to repay it. So there is some things to keep in mind when you are even spending throughout the season, let alone Christmas. So one would be to set a budget and make sure that it's a realistic budget.
Right.
So you have to keep in mind that we do still need to live, even though we're eager to pay down that debt. We can't forget about the essentials. We have those other bills, heating costs, water bills, all of that. So we need to make sure that it's a realistic, attainable budget where you can afford to pay that debt back in a timely manner, as well as not forget to live.
Okay.
Also, it would be a good idea to save for Christmas now, which I
mean, start for next year.
Right.
At this point. I guess for December at this point. Yeah.
Right. Ideally, that would be everybody's situation that they like to do. Mm-hmm. So if you know that you have spent about $1,200 this Christmas, probably going to need about $1,200 or maybe a bit more for next season. Mm-hmm. So what I like to tell some of my members is that talk to your financial institution or talk to someone, and if it's doable, set aside about $100 per month, and then you know this time next year when you're getting ready to spend for Christmas that you have that money already set aside. As well as if you're using debt to pay for things all the time, it's tough to get out of debt when you are using that debt.
Getting out of the hole you created.
Correct, yeah. So if you are using your credit card or any type of revolving credit that way, if you're making a payment on it and then going ahead and making a purchase of the same amount, mm-hmm. you're not getting anywhere.
Right.
Yeah. So the other thing would be, again, to save for next Christmas, like mm-hmm. I already said. And if you're able to do some biweekly or monthly, whatever is attainable for your when you get paid.
And you can also arrange to have that come out automatically, correct? So if that's easier than trying to remember?
Absolutely, yeah. So you can set up a pre-authorized transfer into any savings or a term that's locked in forever, any dollar amount that you mm-hmm. choose.
And if people are just kind of overwhelmed, Tracy, what's the best place for them to go to get started? Where should they start? If they're looking at all their bills and saying, I don't even know what to do.
That's a great question. I think that what people need to realize is that it is okay to ask for help. Reach out to your financial institution. They're going to be objective. They're going to be empathetic of the situation. Mm-hmm. They're going to probably offer solutions for you that you may never have thought of.
So now's the time, basically, right? Don't let it go a couple of weeks or a couple of months, even longer, if you don't have to, because I know it's easy for people to say, well, I'll go next month, or I'll go the month after. And the next thing you know, it's the summer, and you're still even more behind than you thought, correct?
Exactly, yeah. So the sooner you can get a hold of taking control of that debt is better. Again, reach out to your financial institution, and mm-hmm. like I said, they probably will offer solutions that you wouldn't have thought of, being so close to the picture and not being able to see overall, mm-hmm. they're going to be able to offer some advice for you.
So should you set up an appointment? Is that the best thing to do, is to start that way, just make the call and try and schedule something? Or can they just go into the branch, or what's the best way to do that?
Either option is good. You can reach out to our contact center. Mm-hmm. You can call 306-825-3301,
okay.
or stop in at the branch. The concierge desk or the tellers would be able to help you out. Or you can go online to synergycu.ca.
Okay, great. Well, thank you so much for joining us today, Tracy. We really appreciate it. And, you know, again, it's just something where, in this case, if people have a small amount of debt, or even if it's a big amount, you guys can handle either of those scenarios, correct?
For sure. We would definitely offer some options to help you out.
Okay, great. Well, thank you for joining us today, Tracy.
Thank you for having me.
I'm Justin with Boom 101.9 and Hot 93.7, and here's what's happening. Snowmobile drag races, they are going down at the Vermilion Airport on January 25th and 26th. That is 2 days of races and 2 days of prizes. If you want to race in this, racer registration starts at 8 a.m. and it goes till 10. Then the racing kicks off at noon. $10 a ticket, or if you're a family, $25, so not too bad. For more information, you can either check out our websites or call Warren at 780-581-0176. The Wainwright Minor Soccer Association presents AB Comedy Night with Adam Blank and friends. This 18-plus event is happening January 31st at the Wainwright Communiplex. Proceeds will be going towards the soccer field redevelopment project, and you can grab your tickets at Wainwright Auto Repair, Bumper to Bumper, and Triag Implements. Now, going to Vegas is a lot of fun, but it can be a little dangerous for the wallet. So if you want to have the Vegas experience without the travel, then check out Vegas and Vermilion. That is happening on February 7th. There's going to be cocktails, a gourmet three-course meal, and then a two-hour fun casino where everyone's a winner. Tickets for that are also available now. I'm Justin with Boom 101.9 and Hot 93.7, and that's what's happening.
Becca from the SPCA, and she's brought in this gorgeous cat, Jade, a long line of gorgeous cats yeah. from her litter, as yes. we were talking about. But what is so amazing about Jade is that she wants to be held, and yeah. she wants that affection.
Yes.
Not many cats are like that, yeah. have that kind of personality.
Yeah.
So this one's kind of a special kind of cat.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know about breed or anything, but I mean, she's just so pretty. And like, we all joke around that they're from royal bloodlines. But yeah, she came in with her sister and her brother. And they're all three are quite good looking kitties, and they're all quite affectionate and just, oh, don't ruin that. And they, yeah, they all just love their attention and things like that. So I believe that they were just, they were a litter on a farm. Mm-hmm. So they came in when we had the space, and they've been kind of hanging out since. So yeah, we're just trying to, she's not spayed yet, but she was ready for her camera debut today. So I brought her to show her off. But yeah, people can come to the shelter and they can put holds on her as well too if they're interested in her.
And so we know her personality with humans is very amazing. Mm-hmm. She loves being around humans. How is she with her siblings or other cats that she's come in contact with?
Yeah, we took the brother out. He was just being kind of a pest with them. But so we put him in a condo with other boys and he's happy. He loves that. So he was good with them, but I think that they just weren't playing as rough as he would have liked to play. Yeah. We put her and her sister in a condo with another female cat. And that one, that other female, she just wants to love them up all the time. And they're pretty good together. Every so often, they kind of bat each other in the head a little bit when they're in their space. But other than that, they're all good with each other. So I think she would be good if there was another cat in the home that was friendly with cats and she went to a home there as well. I think she would be perfect.
And has she reacted to any of the dogs barking or maybe if they've been in passing with her?
For the most part, like we have one tricky dog in there. She gets out every once in a while and so everybody's a little puffed up after that. But I mean, she hasn't full out tried to attack them through the bars or anything yet anyway. So she'd probably be a little bit cautious to begin with. But I think, again, if it's a friendly animal coming up to her, then I think she'd probably warm up enough.
And just by the looks of it, she'd be okay with smaller children.
Oh, I think yeah. So, yeah. If anything's going to give her attention, I think she's going to like it.
And so the weather has been not so great lately. Very cold temperatures.
Yes.
You did mention a little bit off camera that you had two sets of kittens come in who were just left on the
just
side
left
of the road.
Just left on the side of the road,
is
yeah.
that what the trend is coming up throughout the months?
You know, unfortunately, we've seen that in this last couple weeks here. I mean, you know, like, you know, we will take in kittens if they absolutely need be. Like, if someone cannot hold on to them for us, you know, and it's out in the cold, we'll take kittens. Like, we'll always take kittens and injured animals, too. So, I mean, as full as we are, we will make space for those ones. I mean, again, kittens, they tend to go quite a bit faster than the adult cats do. But then there's just always, like, obviously, just don't do that. That's terrible, right? But, but you know, like, there's always other ways. Like, we see it on the Lloyd Nary Missing Pets page. There's always those bins that are posted with straw. And just ways to keep these stray cats warm for the time being until we do have that space. So you can always try just making something like that just to keep them a little bit safer until we can fit them in.
So it's safe to say that you are pretty full as of now. Are you full still dog-wise? I know you had a litter of puppies.
We're not doing too bad for dogs now, so we are looking at the waiting list to bring in a few more. Oh, bless you. And so we're not doing terrible. We do have a group of puppies out in foster right now, but we probably won't see them for another month and a half. But we're over the little vacation time frame there, we definitely lowered on our numbers and dogs, so we're good on that end.
And is there any events or anything that the SPCA is getting involved with any coming up?
Not right now. Like I said, in February we have a couple adoption events coming up at Pet Valley and PetSmart. And then just right now we're working on tax season. So that's a fun part that we're doing right now too. So,
of course.
Yeah.
And just really quickly before we wrap up, Jade hasn't been spayed yet.
No.
But what kind of is the timeline for when she and some of the other cats will be available?
Yeah, we're hoping within the next couple weeks that we'll get them in. We have quite a few females that need to be spayed, so the spays take a little bit longer than the neuters do. But we have a few males going to Lakeland College, so that'll free up some space at the vet clinics for them. So yeah, we're definitely hoping for in the next couple weeks.
All right, well, thank you so much for bringing in this gorgeous cat, and hopefully she'll be able to find her forever home other siblings soon.
Manage your waste and recyclables with Quick Pick Waste Disposal. 100% locally owned and proud to serve and support the communities we call home. Quick Pick, the convenient solution to avoid pollution.